Welcome to the 2016 Candidates Forum, brought to you by the Wallingford Community Women. I'm Jean McFarland, the program moderator. This program features the candidates running for state representative in the 85th, 86th, 90th, and 103rd Assembly districts. The format will be as follows. The first part of the program will consist of questions asked of the candidates by members of the local media, including the New Haven Register and the Record Journal, and students from Lyman Hall and Mark T. Sheehan High Schools. A member of the Wallingford Community Women will ask questions submitted by the public. There will be a brief intermission, and the concluding portion of the program will allow each candidate to make a closing statement. That will be after a set of questions. During the question and answer portion of the program, the candidates will respond to questions in groups of four. The first questioner will ask a question of the first candidate in a group. The candidate will be allowed 2 minutes to respond. The following initial response, each other candidate within a group will be offered a comment period of 1 minute. The next questioner will ask a question of the first candidate in the second group, and so on as we proceed. There are members of our organization who also will be holding up signs so that they're color-coded and to let you know that you're running out of time or that you have a minute left. Excuse me. Before the questioning, I'd like to introduce the candidates running for state representative in the 85th Assembly District. Serge Mulhaly is Republican and Mary Mashinsky is Democrat. In the 86th Assembly District, we have Vincent Candelora, Republican, and Vincent Mace petitioning. In the 90th Assembly District, we have Craig Fishbein, Republican, and Patrick Reynolds, Democrat. And in the 103rd Assembly District, we have Andrew Falvey, Republican, and his opponent, Liz Linehan, Democrat, had an emergency last minute and is not able to attend this evening, but has a statement to make at the very end, which we will read for you. So let's get started. Luther Termel of the New Haven Register, will you ask your first question of Mr. Mulhaly, please?
Good evening, Mr. Mulhaly. If you were given the opportunity to change the way public schools are funded in the state of Connecticut, how would you go about it, and could you please be as specific as possible?
Well, first of all, I want to say thank you for this gathering. It's very important for the public.
Thank you. I want to say thank you. I hope I keep my time on that. I'd like to say thank you for the group here and everybody that showed up. I think it's very important that we have this discussion. First of all, one of the comments I made at another debate was the fact that the judge who handed down the decision was absolutely correct. I have over 10 years of experience as a teacher. I think it was absolutely disgraceful that you had the more wealthy towns get $5 million more than they should have, and the towns that didn't have as much money get $5 million less. That should have been caught in the beginning. As far as funding, that's not a question to just throw off the top of your head. The state of Connecticut has such a ridiculous, I looked at it, it's written in such a way that it's not supposed to be understood. It's written in such a way that it is purposely complicated. So nobody in the state government has any idea how to do it. And that's why we have this, I consider it corruption in a state government. That needs to end. We need to have the teachers, we need to have the Board of Education, we need to have people from outside Connecticut to sit down and say, wait a minute, this is unfair. We also have to do it, I think, by performance. We should take pride in the fact that if a school has good grades, that people are passing, then maybe they shouldn't get as much money. Instead of rewarding people for that need money, we should reward people for performance, positive performance. I think everything is turned upside down. education as a former teacher, and I've taught in public school, Catholic school. I've also taught juvenile delinquents. I know this pretty well, and I'd be more than happy to go into more detail. Thank you.
Ms. Mishinsky, 1 minute, please.
Oh, the judge is right that the formula is politically crafted, and he was very observant to notice that. It is not getting us where we want to go, which is to reduce the achievement gap and increase the scores and performance of kids in the neglected urban districts. He's very right about that. One of the things the state could do initially, and I have filed this bill, but it has not passed, but one of the things the state could do is to take the special ed kids off the town's responsibility and put them on state responsibility. And then change the formula so that it allows for a longer school year, more additional instruction for the schools that are behind, and again, using performance measurements, improve the schools that need the extra help.
Mr. Candelora.
Thank you. I served about 8 years on a task force under Governor Rell to look at the ECS formula, which funds our education. One of the things I think that is blatantly obvious with this formula is that it's underfunded to begin with. The state never met its obligation to provide all of the funding that it was supposed to for schools. So it's not just the cities that are struggling with funding, it's also our towns. In our community in North Brantford, where I live, we now have, we used to pay, about the state would cover about 25% of the education funding. It's now reduced down to under 20%. So that flat funding has caused a problem for the state, and I think we need to put more money into that formula. I also agree we need to have the state fund special education, because if a student moves from one town to another and might be more costly, that throws a Board of Education budget upside down.
Mr. Mace?
Yes, thank you. I agree that special education children should be funded by the state as well. I think the judge's decision to have the state be responsible for spreading the money out over many of the urban cities where a lot of your scores are very low compared to the urban area, the suburban areas where they're very high, is certainly imperative that the legislature look at that there and try and follow the guidelines, whatever we're setting the decision, so that we could raise the inner city scores up to a level where the suburban scores are. I think much of the problem is teachers being qualified to run their classrooms, and I think if the principals and the superintendents are able to have some autonomy so that they could raise the test scores for the students, then it should be fine. Thank you.
The next question, Aaliyah Noon, would you please ask the question of Mr. Fishbein?
Good evening, Mr. Fishbein.
Good evening, Aaliyah.
While this question is not salient to me now, it will be in my future. The state of Connecticut has pension obligations that are underfunded and in danger on not being able to pay its retirees in the future. What do you propose to remedy the situation?
Well, some people have spoken about redoing the agreements that were done in the past, and I'm against that. You know, we have a contract with retirees. We represented to them that you work for the state and these are the benefits you're going to get. And that's an arrangement, a contract that we entered into. And it just defies logic to me to go back and say, you know, we're pulling the wool out from under you and we're going to redo it. I think that's a priority. You know, part of the problem is that my understanding is that the funding of the pensions has diminished all the way back to the 1930s or so. And since then, it's been a rolling snowball downhill. We have the largest unfunded pension liability, my understanding is, in the country. But I think it needs to be addressed. So I think it's a priority that we have to pay for. And I don't foresee right now redoing that process. So, thank you.
Mr. Reynolds.
guess I agree with Mr. Fishbein. Now, I firmly believe that the commitments that we've made to the state employees, you know, the ones that are retired now, you know, you can't go back. Looking ahead, I mean, again, with the fiscal situation in this state, I mean, we need to look down the road. We need to sit down with labor and see what we can come up with. Again, I agree with Mr. Fishbein. This can has been kicked down the road for decades by both Republicans and Democrats. But we need to look into the future. Again, I've got other ways of increasing revenue, and then that could offset future pensions. Thank you.
Mr. Falvey.
Thank you. The pension problem has grown over the years for a couple of reasons. One, certainly it has been underfunded, but two, the rules by which people can accumulate time for their pension were very badly negotiated and put into place. What I've been able to do on the Town of Cheshire Town Council is we negotiated contracts with unions where new employees would come under a defined contribution plan as opposed to being in the defined benefit plan. That in the long run will help to take some of the burden off the pensions. I would like to see the state of Connecticut do the exact same thing and slowly wean itself off of the archaic defined benefit pension plans. But we have to make sure that we fund as required. The longer we take to fund the deficit in that particular account, the harder it's going to be to balance that account.
Thank you. The next question will be from Sarah Auschler from Lyman Hall High School of Ms. Mashinsky.
Good evening, Ms. Mashinsky.
Evening, Sarah.
With state college tuition becoming more expensive every year, what are your plans to restrict rising tuition costs so all have the opportunity to attend?
We did one thing this year, which is to set up a pool at Chesla for student loans to be brought down to a lower percentage. And if the students who already have loans outstanding contact Chesla, they can get a 4.5% interest rate. And if they need a cosigner, it's a different rate. But this will allow people that already have outstanding loans to get it under control. Otherwise, what we can do is regain control over the state, UConn in particular, which has a rapidly rising rate of expense, and regain control over their budget. We at one point let them decide their own budget, and in retrospect, that was a mistake. It allowed them to do repairs faster, fix leaky roofs, that kind of thing, but it also we also lost our control over the rate of expense rises at UConn. The four state university schools, however, are still affordable, and people that go to school there can actually pay off their loans before they even finish school.
Mr. Candelora.
Thank you. That's a difficult question. I think we have a lot of spectrum of costs to our education. As Representative Mashinsky pointed out, UConn is at a certain level. I think our state schools are still affordable and we need to keep it that way. We are investing more in our community colleges, working with manufacturing to make community college more appealing and job ready when people graduate. And I think that's important to continue to do that. I think there's some tweaks that we could make to our governor's scholarship program, how those are administered so that people who are part-time that might be re-entering the workforce aren't penalized and are able to take a caseload and receive financial aid from that program. So I think there are tweaks in that way that we can open it up for especially the non-traditional students who are going back to school to be re-educated to allow them access to those funds a little bit easier. But otherwise, certainly, I think, community colleges and our those type of education are still available.
Mr. Mace?
Yes, it's a good question. I am a graduate of South Central Community College, which is now Gateway Community College, and I'm also a graduate of Southern Connecticut State University. So I'm a firm believer in our state's colleges, and they are affordable. And also, not only for the younger generation, but also for the older generations like myself. A good thing about the local colleges is that if you can't afford to have to live on campus, room and board and everything else, many of them are in close proximity to your house, so you can commute back and forth until you get to understand the college process. And parents with the PLUS loans and the students, I think the Southern Connecticut, Central, Eastern, and Western, as well as the 13 community colleges, are affordable as they are right now. Thank you.
Mr. Mahaley.
Well, as far as the colleges are concerned, it's great to have a degree, but if you go out in the workforce and there's not a job out there, and you can't pay anything off. I think we need to, and I talked to one of the finest financial advisors in the country. She was top 1%, and she was saying that the kids need to go maybe to a local college instead of going to private right away. It's one of the things I think is very important. The colleges, I was thinking about education here, but actually lost my train of thought, so I'm kind of out of an answer here. So can you just repeat that quickly? I was thinking so hard.
With state college tuition becoming more expensive every year, what are your plans to restrict rising tuition costs so all have the opportunity to attend?
All right, thank you. This is a financial issue. Colleges, the expenses have exploded. Like I said, you cannot afford college, and the state is being bankrupt, and the people responsible for that are career politicians, and they need to get out of office. We have to have new people in office. My opponent's been in for 36 years, raised taxes all the time. Taxes is not a way to solve problems. Thank you.
The next question would be Mr. Zabrick from the Record Journal of Mr. Reynolds.
Good evening, Mr. Reynolds.
Good evening.
Should the state legalize marijuana as a way to generate more tax revenue, or do public health concerns outweigh the financial boost?
I'll be honest with you, this is a tough question. I mean, first and foremost, I want to still see what the overall effects down the road will be in the states where it's been legalized, Colorado. I'll go on the record that I do not believe that a person should spend even a second incarcerated for possession of under a certain amount of marijuana. The problem I have, though, and I also have the problem with the other what we call sin taxes on liquor, tobacco. Many in this room may have a drink occasionally. Hopefully nobody smokes, but you might. But you have people out there that become addicted to it. And to me, it just seems where we are drawing money, let me also throw in gambling, that we are taking almost advantage of an addiction to create or bring in revenue. As far as marijuana, I'm not an expert as far as I've never really heard that it was an addictive drug. But the thing is, though, if let's say we go through this, let's say we legalize possession of marijuana, what I want, and we're going to, let's say it gets voted in that we have a tax, that tax money has to be devoted 100% to the other drug problems we have, and especially the opiates. It has to be. I don't want to see, like, the lottery was first started, it was going to help the elderly and education. It went into the general fund, and that was it. So if we legalize marijuana and we tax it, then again, I want to see that all of that money devoted to helping others that have serious drug problems. Thank you.
Mr. Falvey.
Thank you. No, I am not at all in favor of legalizing and then taxing marijuana or any other drug. We have a drug problem in this state, in our country. I was speaking with one of the chiefs of police in the district, in the 103rd district, and he's vehemently opposed to that happening. I talked to another law enforcement official who lives within the district, who is 100% in favor of it. So there's a wide range of latitude there, but I am not in favor of it. I don't see any reason why we should just be finding more revenue sources just to tax for the sake of bringing in money. We have a spending problem that needs to be corrected, and adding more money to it won't help it. The tax money that comes in won't be dedicated to any particular program. It'll end up in the general fund like everything else, and you'll never see it again.
Mr. Fishbein.
Thank you. I'm against utilizing the legalization of marijuana to balance the budget and to solve the fiscal crisis, because that doesn't stop the spending aspect. The just looking for another pot to fund the addiction to spending that's going on in the legislature doesn't end the problem. And we need to deal with the spending. We need to deal with the out-of-control bonding. We need more local control as to where our tax dollars are going in Hartford before we open the floodgates to something like this. Somebody said recently, and we've all been asked this question at every forum, you know, if you're going to go down that road, you might as well legalize prostitution, which I'm against, you know. But, you know, you just open the floodgates to solve the fiscal crisis, and I'm adverse. So thank you.
Next question will be from Mrs. Shavey of the Wallingford Community Women, and it's a general public question. Please ask of Mr. Candelara.
Do you believe that supporting your political party is more important than voting your conscience and representing your constituents?
The most important thing serving, and I've served over the last 10 years, it's been a pleasure, is absolutely serving your constituents. There are times, certainly, when I sat through the decision to abolish the death penalty, where that could be a highly personal decision, and it will certainly invoke your own personal values in taking that vote. But I think it's critically important that we have our constituents in mind when we're taking a vote. One of the wonderful things that I think Connecticut has is a part-time legislature. And we are a citizen legislature that have part-time jobs. And because of that, I think, and my job is in the town of North Brantford in the 86th District, you stay connected to the community better than if you were a full-time legislator. And so having that experience of going back into the community, I have three children in the public schools, interacting with them, you think of all of those things and you bring that back with you up to Hartford. And I think that is the most critically important thing. Generally speaking, on most issues in Hartford, both sides of the aisle work together. I think the budget, which you hear about so much, is probably the most partisan issue where we do divide. But I think that most representatives that are up there are doing what they think is best for their districts, and I think that's the most important thing.
Mr. Mace?
Yeah, 42 years as a union official and currently the past 11 years as a union president. I'm a firm believer, and I've had to do this here many, many times. The members, the body speaks, and you do what they tell you to do. You work for them. So being from the 86th District, if I'm elected by the constituents, I do what they tell me to do. I work for them. I do not work just for the Democratic Party. So I'm a firm believer in that. If I'm elected, I will work for the constituency, and whatever they direct me to do, that's what I will do. Thank you.
Mr. Mahaley.
Excuse me. No, it's not about the party. It's about the issue. When I go out and talk to people and I knock on doors, they say, are you a Republican and Democrat? Well, I'm under the Republican Party, and I'm trying to get elected. That's the way you get elected, through the party. But it's the issues. And you can't say I'm going to be for the people necessarily, because you have two people with two different ideas. What are you going to do, split yourself in half? It makes no sense. And the way this government was set up, if you read a little bit of James Madison, I've read the Federalist Papers, he said you have to get the general idea and make the best decision possible. That's the answer to the question. Just to go back to the marijuana question, I did specific studies for this. Did you know that the Attorney General and the Governor said it was a failure? Look it up. Look on NEOA. It's the Narcotics Enforcement Officers Association. I spoke to Mr. William Butka, who was a 20-year police officer here. He says it's absolutely the wrong thing to do. Thank you.
Ms. Mashinsky?
My committee is completely bipartisan. I'm on either ranking member or chair, depending on the year, of program review investigations. It's half Democrats, half Republicans. So we can't even send anything out of committee unless it has bipartisan support. And that's most of my duty right now at the Capitol. I do survey the district every January, and I have a pretty good feel for what they want me to work on. Even if there are cut choices or tax choices, I run those by the district, and they fill out the thing and send it back in or email it back in. And as Vin said, almost everything we do is a consensus decision in the Capitol. Most of the bills pass bipartisanly. The budget, however, is done by one party or the other, whoever is responsible for paying the bills. And that's really where the differences show up.
Thank you. Mr. Chmiel, would you please ask the next question of Mr. Falvey?
Andy, I'd like to turn to the subject of economic development. How would you go about improving the state's business climate and attracting more businesses, keeping businesses that are already in existence in place, and allowing people in the state to start more businesses? And please, please don't say, get out of the way and let business do what it does best, because that's what I've heard all campaign season.
Then I probably don't have an answer. What we need to do is we need to create a climate where businesses can have a good idea of what's coming at them. We can't have increasing regulations, changing tax codes, and in other ways in which a business just doesn't know how to budget for the coming year, how to know whether they can expand. If it's a manufacturer, they might need new equipment. They want to hire more people, but they don't know what's coming down the line ever. So we need to have an environment that allows them to look further down the road and make their own plans. Businesses plan 2, 3, 5, 10 years into the future. We have a 2-year budget at the state, so every 2 years, everything changes. And that is driving businesses crazy, and it's driving them out of the state. We do have a problem with businesses leaving. Wallingford saw that with Bristol-Myers Squibb, GE, so many others. And it's not just a state problem, that becomes a local problem. The local communities lose a large amount of property tax dollars when something like that happens, and it becomes an immediate impact locally. So we need to, we need to have a climate that allows a business person, large or small, to plan for their own future so that they can help their own business grow, which in turn will allow them to hire more people, pay better wages, and create an economy in our state that will continue to grow. So it'll feed on itself if we get out of the way and let the businesses do what they do best.
Mr. Fishbein.
So you give me half the time to say the same exact thing. So I'll stay away from the cliche. But one of the things is, you know, as a lawyer, I've represented a lot of people that have come up against the state of Connecticut fighting ridiculous regulations, fighting regulations that hamper businesses. If I had 2 minutes, I could probably give you a couple of examples, but I'm not going to be able to do that. You know, one example is the Home Improvement Contractors Act. Requires a business owner to go through certain hoops when they enter into a contract with a residential homeowner. It doesn't exempt from that process emergency services. And as part of that contract, you have to give the homeowner a 3-day rescission period. Well, when they've got water that's coming through their ceiling and they're saying to the repair person, you know, I need you to fix this now, and the law is saying you have to give them 3 days a rescission, that doesn't make sense. And when these businesses go to court to try and collect, yeah, see, that's out of time. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Reynolds.
Well, I better get going. A couple of things I'd like to see. If I'm elected, the first one would be energy co-ops, grouping up businesses together. Maybe they can save money buying as a group. Set up a phone line, I call it One Call for All, where you have businesses that can call this line and find out about grants, available state money. Seed money for new businesses, you can give tax incentives to the people loaning the money. Also, adjust curriculum at our local colleges to get the students up to date so they will be work-ready when they graduate. Also, have the companies have the ability to piggyback on purchase of materials that the state makes, so they can get the cost savings. And obviously, you have to take a serious look at infrastructure. You know, if you're having a problem getting your materials in and your goods out, that's going to cut into your bottom line.
Thank you.
Yep.
Ms. Noon from Sheehan High School, would you please ask the next question of Mr. Mace?
Connecticut is one of several states that adopted both Common Core and related SBAC testing that goes with the state standards. Many students, like myself, teachers, and parents, have objected to the testing in our public schools. Would you support a parent's right to opt their child out of testing, and do you want Connecticut to eliminate Common Core and SBAC testing from our schools altogether?
No, I won't support legislation that would have a parent opt out of the standardized testing. One of the problems in the state school system is that we use testing scores to determine whether or not a school is doing good or a school is doing bad, and how we're going to fund that. And if half the parents of that particular school decide that they want to opt their child out of that testing process, then how do we determine whether the school is doing good or bad, or how do we determine whether teachers are doing what they're supposed to do within the school system? So, and especially with the recent decision by the judge saying that Connecticut has the Constitution says that we have an obligation to support the school systems and make sure that the monies go so that everybody gets an equal education. And how can we determine if students are getting an equal education if their parents are refusing to have them test it? How do we measure that? And as we go through everything with the school system, it's unfortunate, but we have to take tests all along the way. And if you want to get into college, you have to take tests. You have to take the SATs or the MCATs or whatever you want to do. So, no, I would not support legislation that would have a parent unilaterally opt out of a child getting tested for the test scores. Thank you.
Mr. Mahaley?
Absolutely. Parents have the fundamental right to take care of their kids. Common Core is a disaster. I've been endorsed by Connecticut Against Common Core. You can look them up, the young lady who heads that, and I've seen, in fact, I know her fairly well. Common Core is insidious. What it teaches you is to go against the parents. I do not believe anybody should be taking Common Core, period. And I fundamentally believe education should be three things. It's called a triumvirate. Should be the parent, the child, and the teacher. We have too many bureaucrats all across the state of Connecticut government, but also in education. That's one of the things we need to do, is get the bureaucrats out of government. Government is too big. It's been supported by career politicians like my opponent, Mary Mashinsky, who's been in office for 36 years. That's wrong.
Ms. Mashinsky?
Our town already uses Common Core. They started using it before Common Core was actually structured and distributed around the state, but we were actually ahead of any use of Common Core statewide. Because Dr. Menzo is a pioneer and he was willing to go in and use the standards. But you have to, it's a public funded institution. Taxpayers pay for it. It's the largest expense at the municipal level. And you really have to have accountability to make sure the students are achieving and to help districts that are not achieving. We do need to do some level of testing before students graduate. My committee found that we were spending remediation money in the first year of community college for stuff that should have been learned in high school. And community college is much more expensive, so we need to catch people who are not achieving at the high school level before they move on to higher education.
Thank you. The next question for round two will be from...
Oh, wait, you forgot.
Oh, I'm sorry. Mr. Candelora.
Thank you.
Sorry.
So Common Core, the implementation, I think, was an absolute disaster on a statewide level. And but the horses left the barn. I think that the teachers adapted. They took on, as Representative Mashinsky pointed out, Wallingford did implement it sooner. In other towns, teachers had to take on a lot and rewrite the curriculum, essentially. In terms of opting out of the tests, I think we need to have that conversation to allow parents to opt out. In particular, in 11th grade, when we're testing the SBAC, that was not for the students' benefit, that was for the state's benefit in data collection. I do get concerned with that SBAC test in that we are collecting data and centering, taking students' information and sending that information out, again, not for the benefit of the children. We have benchmarks that we also put the children through the education process with Common Core. And I think we need to start look at that. We are over-testing the kids. We're teaching to the tests. And I'm also concerned with teachers being evaluated
Thank
by
you.
The test.
Okay, the next round. Mr. Zabrick, would you please ask the question of Mr. Mahaley?
Please name one thing the legislature can do to ease the burden on municipal property taxes.
Not tax them so much in the first place. Money needs to stay at home. If I had my druthers, I'd go back, I'd get rid of the income tax, I'd go back to property tax, go back to the sales tax, go back to before 1991. My opponent, Mary Mashinsky, voted for the income tax. Ever since then, the state has fallen apart. That tax passed by one vote. She didn't vote for it, the tax may not be here. There's no excuse for taxes, not at the rate we have. We have to shrink government. We have to think with bold ideas. I am sick and tired of a government that deals with small issues, small ball. This government and the state government has to be looked at. I've gone over the budget. There is so much duplication. It's absolutely sinful. We can talk all day about this and this and this, but we have an 8-cylinder engine that's inefficient, and it's burning more gas than we can afford. That's why we keep taxing. Mr. Kennedy says, oh, what we're gonna do is all of a sudden we're gonna open the tolls. That's more money out of our pockets. Everybody's leaving the state. Mrs. Esty says, oh, the Republicans, they're painting a terrible picture. Ms. Esty and all the Democrats who don't know what the heck they're doing, those are called facts. People are leaving the state because they know it's a disaster in Connecticut. The reason I'm here, the reason I'm running, is I am sick and tired of this, and I think a lot of people on this board are the same way, and I think you are too. It's time for a dramatic change, not just a shade of gray here and a shade of gray here. We need to turn over everything. I want to see term limits. I think every single candidate needs to say yes or no. Am I going to vote for term limits? I will. I make a pledge today on camera, on video, that I will.
Thank you. Ms. Mashinsky?
This year, I was able to bring back additional town aid more than last year, about 300,000 more. And it was a tight year, too. It was hard to do, but the town does depend on delivery of state aid to help the town pay for education, public safety, and so on. The towns as a group have asked for a change that would help them with their budget, which is to change the threshold for prevailing wage. It hasn't changed since 1991. So now for 100,000 for repairs or 400,000 for new construction, that's the current ceiling for prevailing wage, but the towns have asked for a 400,000 threshold for repairs and 1 million for new construction, as prices have changed since 1991. And then another thing we could do is pick up the special ed costs for the towns. And I have filed this bill before. Some of the individual cases are $100,000 per special ed student because they have to be sent
to
an institution out of town.
Mr. Candelora?
Yeah, it's a difficult question. There's not a silver bullet, I think, answer. Connecticut has very complex problems. One of the things is we need to meet our obligation on education. It's the biggest cost driver in the state of Connecticut, and the state has underfunded that. I certainly do agree with Representative Mashinsky that the prevailing wage thresholds can be adjusted. I think there's other municipal mandates that we could take a look at. But we need to maintain the promises. When we increase municipal aid and then we take away the property tax credit for taxpayers on their homes. That's not giving towns tax relief. And so, you know, we have a lot of work to do, I think, beyond just one silver bullet, and those are just a few examples.
Mr. Mace?
Yeah. Certainly, the education, having the special ed funded by the state would certainly give some relief to the towns. But also, I think one of the major problems is the state has to be able to come up with a balanced budget. And once the state can come up with a balanced budget and stay within the spending cap, then after they accomplish their obligations under the spending cap, then they could finance other programs to aid the states and municipalities. Therefore, that would certainly reduce the property taxes. And one of the things I've looked at is bonding and bond premiums in order to facilitate a surplus of money so that they can give to the towns or local municipalities in order to reduce the burden on the towns for education and for property taxes. That's what I would recommend.
Thank you. Ms. Shavey, would you please ask the next question of Mr. Fishbein?
What is your position on balancing the state budget? Would you propose raising taxes for citizens, for businesses?
Well, first of all, the state should have a balanced budget. Right? That is my position. But a portion of the problem is the spending cap that we recently heard about, that evidently the legislature passed, but the Attorney General has now said that we don't have to, it doesn't really exist. I am not in favor of raising taxes to meet another level of spending. I believe that was part of your question. We are in serious times, and the biggest problem that we have is out of control spending and bonding for things by the state that really should be taken on by the municipalities individually. It's a major part of our budget and should be addressed more locally where there's actual control. So, thank you.
Mr. Reynolds.
With any budget, you know, you need a balance between money coming in and money going out. Let me look at the expense side. Yes, bonding is a big issue. I mean, it's another name for a credit card. I mean, when you look at the city of Meriden renovated two high schools, Platt and Maloney, to the tune of $250 million, and we taxpayers paid 80% of that. We don't have that kind of money. On the revenue side, I've gone on the record saying that we need to keep our retirees in this state. I'm going to advocate for a reduction or elimination of state income tax, not only on Social Security, but also on pensions. We also need to keep our students in the state, and we need to partner up, again, businesses with colleges, adjust the curriculum, so when the students come out, they can get a job. So those are the big two areas, I think, that I would address anyway as far as increasing revenue. And once again, as far as expenses, bonding is a big one.
Thank you. Mr. Falvey?
I believe the question was, who would I raise taxes on, business or people? Neither. I wouldn't raise taxes. The state has a spending problem. It does not have a revenue problem. $2 billion in additional revenue in the past couple of years in additional taxes, and still a $2 billion deficit. What we need to do, and what I've been talking about from day one in my campaign, is I want to look at every agency, every department within the state, see exactly what it's doing, and determine whether or not it is a core service that the state should be providing, or if it's not a core service that could be better done either as outsourced or just simply stop doing it entirely. We outsourced the auto emissions program several years ago. It works fine. You can get your driver's license renewed at AAA. That works fine. There are small ideas, but put a lot of them together, and you start to reduce the scope and cost of government. And that's how I would attack that problem.
Thank you. Mr. Tumel, would you please ask the next question of Ms. Mashinsky?
Mary, how would you, I mean, you've been up there for a while, but how should the state going forward go about reducing energy costs, keeping in mind, of course, that a lot of the energy increases are out of state control?
That's true. The price of natural gas and the price of oil is outside of state control. But what the state can do is continue to fund the Green Bank. We use our greenhouse gas funds to assist the Green Bank to make grants and loans to businesses and residents, although it's tough to get them in Wallingford because we're a municipal utility. But in most parts of the state, you can get assistance to put in more efficient technology. There's two REGI projects in Wallingford. One is at Choate School at the Sustainable Campus, and the other is at Gaylord. And the Wallingford Housing Authority has a geothermal heating system, which uses ground heat to heat that, and reduces bills for the tenants that live there. So the technology can help people, both businesses and residents, to save funds, but they usually need the upfront help of the Green Fund to make those investments.
Thank you. Mr. Candelora.
Yeah, certainly the renewables that people are engaging in helps, I think, to reduce personal costs. One of the problems I think Connecticut did was in the last budget cycle, and I did not support this, but a couple budget cycles ago, we imposed, I think it was a 2.5% tax on energy, which made us uncompetitive in the market. And I think those kind of policies sort of has set us back. One of the issues that we're going to be dealing with on the horizon is keeping Millstone open and what impact that will have on our future. And so I think that's an important issue that we are going to need to tackle to help keep our energy costs down.
Mr. Mace.
Yeah, I support nuclear power as well. That certainly is one of the cheapest ways to keep energy costs down. But also we should start looking at, for Connecticut, we should start looking at natural gas. We should be able to get pipelines into Connecticut as long as the taxpayers didn't have to pay for it. And the more we started relying on natural gas, it would certainly bring other energy costs down. And another thing, to give incentives to not only businesses, but to people, homeowners, for solar energy. That would certainly be helpful not only to the residents of Connecticut, but it would also be helpful to the state so that energy costs would come down and everybody would win all the way around. So my concern for energy would be our nuclear power, natural gas, and solar system.
Thank you. Mr. Mihaly?
I have to agree with Mr. Mace.
Mace, yeah.
Mace. And, very good. Focus more on natural gas. The price has gone down. We also see price of gas going down as well. A lot of the cost for energy is dictated outside of Connecticut. The price of gas is being manipulated in the Middle East, but I think that has also to do with our own domestic oil policies and our energy policies. Right now we're hurting and punishing people through the federal government. All that needs to change. As far as I'm concerned, we need to have everything, whether it's solar, natural gas, oil, whatever it is. And so I would have to talk to some of the federal people, say, listen, we've got people suffering here. We need to change policies. And also, like I said, Mr. Mass, had some good ideas. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question will be Ms. Noon. Would you please ask the question of Mr. Reynolds?
We know there will be a leaner budgets from the state of Connecticut this coming year. Everyone running talks about government having to live within its means, but no one has the courage to say where they would specifically cut for fear of angering some special interest group. So be the first candidate running to answer the following question directly and honestly. List three specific programs and dollar amounts that would be saved if they were eliminated or abolished.
Nope.
I mentioned before about bonding. All right. If I get these numbers off a little bit, I believe that it was earmarked, I think, $1 billion for education. And I couldn't give you an exact amount, but I could say that it's maybe 30%. I mentioned what happened in Platt and Maloney. I know this might upset some people, but I think the state has to stop giving out these artificial turf coupons you know, $300,000, $400,000, $500,000 for artificial turf. Number one, I'm not convinced that it's the best turf. And number two, again, we don't have this money. I'm trying to think of where else would I say money. Was that, does that count as two? Sort of. Okay, I know, administrative costs, and especially at some of our universities. Years ago, I was a landscaper, and I was taught the first day that if you want to trim or a bush, you start at the top. You don't start at the roots. It'll kill it. So, for example, UConn. Again, we have a president of UConn that makes $800,000 a year. She has two houses, a driver, 12 people reporting to her. So we definitely have to go into looking into, you know, reducing the administrative overhead. The other thing I would look into, which I don't have the numbers for, is redundancy. We need to look at all the various departments and actually see, is there overlap? All right, can we just focus on one, you know, have one agency handle a particular problem, and the other agency either could be free to do more work or eliminate them. There's already a program at the state now that oversees agencies to see if what they're doing is really needed. I think that's about it.
Thank you, Mr. Falvey.
I stated previously that I want to look at every single agency, every single department, and only have core services provided by the state, and look at that point at what we can get rid of. Bonding is another good example of that. We give away way too much money to the towns for projects because it makes the representative look good, when it really something the town should be doing themselves, not state money. I would also look at the Department of Transportation. I don't believe we need six orange trucks with six drivers sitting there while two guys fill potholes. Again, it may seem like a small item, but when you start adding these different things up, there's where you start getting your savings. The governor said in his opening remarks in February, he wants the state to be looking at core services only. He's never mentioned the word again, so it was just lip service, but I truly believe core services are what the government should be doing, and that's how we can start saving money.
Mr. Fishbein?
Agreed with Mr. Falvey. I do have three areas. I don't have actual specifics, but UConn. You know, UConn should be set up like an enterprise fund. If you're charging tuition at a level and you can still subsidize for in-state students, it should pay for itself. When Representative Mashinsky says, you know, we sort of took the chains off letting them do their own thing, but the spending's out of control, that's a problem. So certainly something can be addressed there. Trains. You know, recently we bonded at $350 million for new train cars for this high-speed rail, but they're going to fully subsidize the rates, the fares. It doesn't make sense. The fares should pay to run the trains. And the third is the bonding. I have, by way of example, and there's no 15-second thing, you paid $10 million to buy open space in Glastonbury in this budget. Ridiculous. In this economy. But I'm out of time.
Thank you. Ms. Ouchler, would you please ask the next question of Mr. Candelara?
Hello. With the increase of violence plaguing our nation, what would be your plans to increase security measures at our schools?
That's a great question, and it was something actually I worked on a couple of years ago after the Sandy Hook tragedy. The district in North Brantford sought to look at security, and they actually wanted to bring armed guards into the schools. To this day, we actually do have armed guards. So I had worked on legislation to allow that to happen and making sure that there's the appropriate training that is put into place. So for districts who do want it, I think Enfield was another one that had implemented it, they have the ability to do that, and we have trained individuals in the schools that could differentiate between, you know, a threat and somebody who might be anxious. I think the other piece that we've also done a good job in the state of Connecticut is providing funding, not just to our public schools, but to our private schools as well, to allow them to fortify the schools, to put in secure doors to open and close. And I think going forward, as we see new construction, we should make sure that when the schools are built, that they're built with those safety measures in mind. so that they're not, you know, the front entrance isn't opening up into a hallway where there's nobody that could see the people entering the building. And I think most architecture is gone in that direction. But I think we should just continue with those measures.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Mace.
Yes, that also goes to another state liability, is to work with the towns to make sure that our precious children in the schools are protected. I'm in favor of having armed guards in the school system, and also the training that they should receive. They should be able to determine some psychological behavior when people enter the school and want to go to the principal's office or to the main office, and there's no threat. And if they have that proper training, and they can identify when somebody would be a serious threat to the children. Also, I believe that at the front door, there should be a desk so that every visitor is stopped before they go down any hallway or any corridor, parent or any other. Everybody should report to the office, and that the security guard knows that they reported to the office and were cleared to enter the building. Thank you.
Mr. Mahaley?
I think pretty much the answers are going to fall in line. I think I want to praise Mr. Candelora for his work. I absolutely agree with armed guards. Our children need to be protected, not just hidden. We have a lot of people who are served overseas. We have ex-police officers that are well-trained, know how to use a firearm in the proper way, if needed. And I think we have to welcome them. I also think we have to work on the mental health issues. I don't think the state of Connecticut or nationwide we're doing the right thing. It's a big, big issue. I think that was one of the things with Sandy Hook. Young man needed a lot of help, and he was just didn't get it. And I think that's a big problem in society. Also, the violence in society, Hollywood and TV, you just have too much. It's absolutely, that spills over. And but we have to make sure we don't have, you know, I don't want to go back to money all the time, but if we ask the town to do it, the state has to also fund it. Thank you.
Ms. Mashinsky?
Right after Sandy Hook, before Sandy Hook, my committee, PR, Program Review Investigations, had done some work on mental health reforms for adolescents, and that was incorporated into the bill for early intervention to head off mental health problems before they go full bloom and to become a threat to the community. But also in the bill, we put grant money for towns to compete for to change the front of their school. At Sandy Hook, the front of the school was glass, and the intruder was able to just burst through there and start killing people. And we now know that that design is a disaster, so we have issued money to the town so they can rebuild the front of their school and armor it, as another legislator said, to make sure the person can't get in unless someone at the front desk lets them in.
Thank you. Mr. Zabrick, would you please ask the next question of Mr. Falvey?
Would you support raising the minimum wage in the next legislative session? And if yes, by how much?
I would not. Endorse raising the minimum wage, except in the area of cost of living inflation. I don't think we need to artificially create a new level and call it the minimum wage. Minimum wage is supposed to be a starting point, not an ending point. First job I ever had was below minimum wage, but I was just a kid. First job I had at minimum wage was in high school. The last job I had at minimum wage was in high school. I worked hard, I did what I needed to do in order to get a raise. I provided a greater value to my employer, and for that, I was getting paid more. An artificial dollar amount of minimum wage, whether it's $12, $15, doesn't solve any problems. People need to work to increase their value to their employers and to themselves, and that, in turn, will allow them to get a higher paying job. It may not be the same job, it might be a better job, it might be whatever they want to do. But just to artificially say, oh, the minimum wage should be X, without any kind of a formula behind it to prove that that's the right number, is
It just makes people feel good, and it doesn't do any work. Thank you.
Mr. Fishbein?
I would be against raising the minimum wage. I too, my first job in high school, I earned the minimum wage for about 6 months, and then I got a raise. I worked hard. And I share Mr. Falvey's position that it's a starting point and not an ending point. I think fundamentally the minimum wage, you know, when we talk about a living wage, it teaches our children you don't need to strive for excellence. You don't need to get an A. C's and D's are good enough, because when you get out of school, you're going to get a living wage. I think it's counterproductive. Also, it rolls downhill. You know, products that have minimum wage workers or the benefit of minimum wage workers get increased in price. And then the people that buy those products are those that are earning minimum wage. So then they say, well, I can't buy those products, so I need more. And it's just a constant circle, and it hurts Thank our you. Economy.
Mr. Reynolds?
Thank you. Now, I believe in minimum wage. I also believe that it should be increased with conditions. Obviously, the mom and pop store with a couple of employees or whatever, you can work with that. But where I really, really get upset is when you see the big box corporations like Walmart that are paying their workers, and these are people that come in every day, they work their tails off, right? And they barely have enough money to make ends meet, whether it's housing or whether it's food. Yet, because of this low wage, they in turn qualify for state assistance. I just did a little research just on Walmart and a checkout, Lowe's or Home Depot, but Walmart costs the state of Connecticut just under $60 million a year. I mean, Walmart doesn't need our subsidies. But again, I think if a person works, he's working hard, and you're talking about adults, they should have enough money for an apartment, enough money to eat. And that's it.
Thank you. Ms. Shavey, would you please ask the next question of Mr. Mace?
What are your thoughts on the vehicle mileage tax?
I think I'd move out of state myself at that point in time. I'm 100% against the vehicle mileage tax. By the time they set up GPSs to your cars to see where you're driving. Recently, I just drove from Connecticut to El Paso, Texas. It was over 2,000 miles, and I would have had to pay mileage tax and all of that. I think the state should look for other ways to find revenue for our infrastructure for our roads. And I'm a big proponent of doing a study for toll booths on the borders. I look at it this way here. I want to go to Massachusetts, I have to pay a toll when I get on the Mass Pike. I want to go to New York, I have to pay a toll on the Mare Parkway. Or if I want to go to New Jersey over to GW, one of the bridges, want to go into New Jersey, I have to pay tolls for the Jersey Pike, the Delaware Bridge. I think Connecticut could sustain border tolls on the Rhode Island line, the Mass line, and the New York line. And with the governor's recommendation of a lockbox for the infrastructure, I think that would definitely support our infrastructure for all of our roads and highways, as opposed to a mileage tax, because the mileage tax is going to be very, very detrimental, especially to your low and middle income people, all right? There's more low and middle income people in the state of Connecticut than there are rich people, and they would get the burden of this here, and it would be definitely unfair. So I'm against a mileage tax.
Thank you, Mr. Mihaly.
Gee, a tax, I think it's a great idea, right? No, absolutely not. First of all, we had people killed on 95 just for the fact we lose lives. Absolutely not. People that live near Mare Parkway, people going to work paid, but people in other places didn't pay. Do you really think more money going to a government that wastes money now, that can't even direct a budget, they're going to use that wisely? No, I don't think so. Again, it's not more money, ladies and gentlemen. It's making government more responsible. It's cutting, not just spending. We say, oh, we have a spending problem. Why do we have a spending problem? Because we have certain things we keep spending for. Oh, I have to have this, I have to have that. We're spoiling ourselves. The private sector needs to say, you know what, I can do this better, I can do it cheaper. I know people who have offered to me that they can do a better job than the state of Connecticut. Go around the country. Look at Illinois, look at Ohio. Ohio had an $8 billion deficit, and the governor there fixed it. What did he do?
Ms. Mashinsky?
My opponent has been telling people at the door that I'm in favor of the mileage tax, so I want to clear up right now that that is not the case. The mileage tax experiment is a grant-funded pilot that the executive branch accepted the grant, and they are testing the idea. The legislature had nothing to do with this. We did not vote on it or anything. What I have done is sent a survey to my district about what version they would like to fund the transportation fund with. And right now, tolls is probably the favored version. It is true that the transportation fund is running out of money. We actually know what year it will run out. This is because of the increased gas mileage of vehicles and the increased use of hybrid vehicles and electric vehicles. And at some point in the future, we know the fund will run out because it is tied to gasoline prices. So we have to address that reality in order to keep our bridges and roads in safe condition.
Thanks.
I want to answer that because I was accused of saying something. No, I have to answer this. I do not go around. I have to answer this. This is a personal attack, professional attack. I do not. And I've asked Ms. Mashinsky and anybody else to come with me to see what I say. I do not say she does it. I say the state of Connecticut does it, and they spent $300,000. I don't like to be accused of things that I didn't do, and I did not do this. Thank you.
Mr. Candelora.
Thank you. So, you know, I'm sorry that the governor even proposed that mileage tax and looked into it, because the message it certainly sent to the state of Connecticut and people looking at moving here is that we're desperate for revenue. That's the message it sent. I certainly oppose the mileage tax. I think it's regressive for people. And I also think the tolls issue, you don't hear a lot about it out of the executive branch, and it's because that there was a study commissioned in 2009 that found that if we put up tolls, we lose our federal highway money. And so it's a wash. There's a zero net sum gain to tolls. So it sounds like a good idea for people, especially if you don't live on the borders. But the implementation of it in Connecticut is almost impossible unless we got federal approval. Thank you.
Thank you. This ends the first segment of our forum, and we will adjourn for approximately 15 minutes and start back up again. Thank you. Thank you. Welcome back to the 2016 Candidates Forum, featuring the candidates running for state representative in the 85th, 86th, 90th, and 103rd Assembly Districts. Sam Morgenstern from Lyman High School, would you please ask the first question of Mr. Fishbein?
Good evening, Mr. Fishbein.
Hi, Sam.
As a student currently entering the college process, what specific measures would you propose in order to make college more affordable for students like me?
Well, I suppose that we would be contemplating an in-state school as part of this process. More affordable. I mean, I think you have to look at the budget of the schools. I mean, UConn, it appears, is getting very expensive. I mean, when I went to college, UConn was about $8,000 a year. And now it's many, many times that. And I understand there's a lot of things that have to be paid for in that process. But when president of the school is making a lot of money, and I don't necessarily begrudge her that she's making so much, but the shackles are off of that process. That trickles down to you as students to pay for things like that. And while I think it should pay for itself, the tuition should pay for itself, UConn itself should look at what the money is going to, and in order to provide a good education. The satellite schools, Central, Southern, it appears are more manageable, and to my knowledge, appropriate as far as what they're costing presently. There's proposals out there for free college education. Nobody says where the money's going to come from. That's something that's been drilled into some people's heads. I think that's just going to make the problem even worse when we are, saddling banks or taxpayers with, paying for college for other individuals. So I hope that answered your question. Not to your satisfaction, but I hope it answered it.
Mr. Reynolds.
Yeah, I have mentioned this before. I think the first thing we need to do, the cost is up now. Trying to reduce it's going to be difficult, but we need to keep, again, looking at the top, the administrative costs. We have to keep that in check. The second thing is one of the biggest problems you're going to have is not just the high cost, but the debt you're going to incur. So if we get the state, just like the federal government did, as a lending institution, all right, keep the rates of a couple points above prime just enough to cover administrative costs, then when you get out and you get a job, and let's say you live in Connecticut, we can work this out 3, 4, 5 years, all right, and you've got a good job and you're putting money in the economy, then what we could do is maybe look at a reduction in your debt. Another thing also, the interest rate on your student loan could be deducted from your taxes. But the big thing again is keeping the cost down, right, or not the slowing down the increase, making it when you borrow money that it's not going to cripple you for the rest of your life. If you incur a debt.
Thank you. Mr. Falvey.
Thank you. I think that the higher education in Connecticut needs to do two things. One, it needs to economize. It's terribly bloated at the top with overpaid administrators who don't do anything as far as education goes. That's both UConn as well as the state university system. We also need to not just economize, but to modernize. We need to change the way we deliver the education product. More online classes, more alternative ways that are less costly to provide classes so that you don't have to pay these exorbitant fees for a lot of things you may not get a whole lot out of anyways. So economize and modernize, and it'll help to hold costs down so they don't continue to rise. Trying to get them to cut the costs would mean to have to, at this point, cut people, and that's going to cause students to not be able to get classes because the professors won't be there, and now you're looking at now 5 years to get through school instead of four, and that just makes your cost even higher still.
Thank you. Mr. Zabrick, would you please ask the next question of Ms. Mishinsky?
The state's three watchdog agencies have warned that additional budget cuts will hinder their ability to fulfill their duties. Should they be protected from future budget cuts, or do they need to share and sacrifice this need to balance the budget next session?
Everyone needs to share in the sacrifice. We had to cut $830 million out of the budget, which is severe. And so no one is exempt. My own committee was not exempt. Lost staff. But we have to maintain the function of the organization. It has to be freestanding, and they have to have the ability to hold accountable any part of the state government and to allow free access to any information. So their core function has to be retained. But I can't really say with the state's deficit situation, I can't really say that no one is protected and should be exempt from cuts. That really isn't fair to all the other important services that we deliver, and human services in particular.
Mr. Candelora.
So these watchdog agencies sort of keep an eye on the executive branch and the legislative branch. The governor had moved it in the budget into under his control. It used to be autonomous. I think those agencies need their autonomy back. And I will say that because when I met with these individuals during the budget cycle, they had been disproportionately cut in the budget. And they were protected ultimately, but I think there's a real conflict of interest here going on with the governor's office, who continues to focus on these agencies and attempt to cut them out of existence while they're investigating his own agency for wrongdoing. So I think the autonomy needs to be returned. The Freedom of Information Commission, state ethics are critical. And their budgets aren't that big in the overall scheme of things. Certainly they have already received cuts, and there may be some down the future, but we can't be making cuts to those agencies that would decimate them.
Mr. Mays?
Yeah, I think it's time that we stop thinking of the glass being half empty. I think we have to start looking at it and say, okay, we know that there's a budget problem, and it's affecting not only the watchdog agencies, but many others. And right now, with the way the legislature's doing, is they're doing a lot of things to cut, as opposed to doing the positive things to say, okay, we have to start building. And a prime example is in 2005, when the treasurer said she recommended that the legislature start doing a certain kind of bonding premium, that today, 11 years later, we would have a $420 million less of a deficit than we would that we currently have. So we have experts out there, and we're not listening to them, all right? When you have 140 voices up there trying to get something accomplished, it's very difficult if we don't break the gridlock, and that's one of the things I think we have to do, is stop looking at the glass half empty, say it's half full, let's build on this, what we have now, not cut. Thank you.
Mr. Mahaley?
I agree with Mr. Candelori. This has to be independent. Cannot have a watchdog agency that is favored by one side. Same thing at any other level of government. As far as cuts are concerned, we all have to save. We all have to suffer, so to speak. We all have to give a little bit, because this includes everybody. I keep saying this needs to be a family, not a village. I don't believe a village. I believe a family. A family, we respect each other. We have to look at that as a state of government, that we have to look and see who needs the most help. I don't like the way they cut DSS. You had people who were in certain homes, they've cut the homes, and you have some very handicapped people that are being terribly affected by this. That's inexcusable. I think we have a moral responsibility to help those, the elderly, children, and those that are sick. We need to have somebody to look over this, make sure everybody is honest.
Thank you. Mrs. Shapey, would you ask the next question of Mr. Reynolds?
What is your position on Connecticut's current strong gun laws?
First, to go on record, I'm a firm supporter of the Second Amendment. And as far as gun legislation, I would be in favor, and this is, I gotta qualify this, I would be in favor of new legislation that would effectively keep guns out of the hands of people that should not have them. Now, with that said, with the, I think you're talking about, what was it, 3 years ago, 4 years ago, that this legislation went through, from what I've read, I guess gun-related crime is down, but I think I'm gonna leave it like that.
Okay. Mr. Falvey?
The gun law that was recently brought as far as U.S. Supreme Court came about as a knee-jerk reaction to the tragedy in Sandy Hook. That law, as it stands, if it was in place, would not have prevented that from happening. Our gun laws are very strong right now. What we have is that we have a mental health problem. We do have guns in the hands of people who should not have them. Most of the crimes, most of the tragedies happen because of mental health issues, not because of gun law issues. The NRA and the Connecticut Citizens Defense League both have endorsed me, and both are adamantly pro safe, responsible use of guns. It can be You can have responsible use, but you cannot have responsible use when somebody can't control themselves. And so in that aspect, yes, we have to make sure guns do not get into the wrong hands. Most of our, as I said, most crimes, most people going to jail, it's more of a mental health issue than a gun issue.
Mr. Fishbein?
So it's a very general question, and I think the modifications that were passed that day comprised almost 200 pages. So it's very difficult to answer that question so general in 1 minute. But there's portions of the law that aren't even being enforced by the state police. For instance, there's an exemption for target pistols that are authorized by the Olympics. The bill specifically orders the state police to put in process, an application process for holders of these firearms to register them with the state and to sign an affidavit that says they will only be used for target practice. Over a year ago, the state police put that process together and gave it to the law department, and it still has not been put in place. It's part of the statute not being enforced. If you're not going to enforce it, take it out or do something different. So I could go on and on, but my time is up.
Thank you. Mr. Trumell, would you ask the next question of Mr. Candelara?
A couple folks on the dais today have raised the issue that we're overbonding, that we're using the credit card, the state credit card, too much. So I'd like to ask you if you agree with that, and if you do agree with that, cite one project in your hometown that if you had the power to, you would have said, eh, it's not, you know, we don't want the bond and the money for this.
So I'll just say I do think we're overbonded. In terms of projects, I just recently sat on the bond commission as a member and voted against every single project that was on there. It was over $680 million. And it's not because I don't like one of those projects. We're well beyond picking a project and saying it's bad. The reason why we're overbonded, is just simple. When we were looking at our budget to put forth, the Republicans were looking at an alternative budget, and we were looking at cutting debt service. And by cutting debt service, you know, you have to reduce your borrowing. And we kept tweaking that number. Well, our Office of Fiscal Analysis came back to us and said, you can't make any more cuts to bonding. We need to keep bonding because we're running out of money to be able to pay our bonds. The state of Connecticut right now has approved $7.5 billion in projects under this governor that we have not yet funded. When he took office, that was at $2.5 billion in projects. So not only do we have about $20 billion in general obligation debt, we have an additional $7.5 billion of projects that have yet to be funded. When towns go to build a school or put a road in, they bond for it right away. The state doesn't do that. They approve the project, they had the ribbon cutting, they give the town the money, but they haven't paid for it yet. So I would say certainly that is going to be the next eclipse that we are going to see in the state of Connecticut. Moody's again has rated us negative. Investors are telling people, stop buying Connecticut bonds. I've had six people in the last 2 weeks come up to me to tell me their financial advisors are now telling them, get rid of your Connecticut bonds. There isn't much more out there that I could say that we have a fire, we need to put it out.
Mr. Mace?
I haven't seen any bonding projects in the 86th district in I don't know how long, and they weren't advertised as bonding projects. But it is true that Mr. Candelora did vote against the recent bond commission on September 30th. 43 projects, he just blanketed, said no to all of them. Those projects went to schools. Those projects went to build a senior center. Those projects went to put people to work. And we need people back to work in order to jumpstart this economy. So if the bonding is done right and the bond premiums raise revenue, and the payback to the investors, if it's done right, it is one of the better ways to fund Connecticut to get the economy going again. And right now, we're not doing that. We can't have someone up there vote carte blanche against 43 projects and say, oh, they're good, but I'm voting against all of them because I think we're over-bonded. We need the bonding as a government entity within business in order to jumpstart the economy and get people back to work. Thank you.
Mr. Mahaley.
I agree that we should stop bonding right now. If I was on the committee, I would vote the same way, would not bond. One of the things, as an example, the Oakdale Theater, they sold $9.2 billion of tickets last year. They had a problem with the sound, and a bond brought up by one of our representatives was for over $1 million of a bond. We need to look into these things and make sure that it's the right thing to do, that Oakdale could pay for this. Government, it's not government's responsibility to get into the private sector. Private sector knows what they're doing. We lost 7,500 people. Government doesn't know how to run a business. It lost 7,500 workers. That should be evidence enough.
Ms. Mashinsky?
Some of the bonds really can't be done except by the state. For example, Wallingford is upgrading its sewage treatment plant to take out phosphorus. I helped get them some additional bond money to do that. Wallingford could not handle that $3.4 million in additional cost without help from the state. So it was important that I was able to get that money to the town. We did redirect existing bond money for economic development this year. We targeted it to innovation hubs, and we reused existing money. The schools have been the largest user of bond money in the past. We have to sit on them to do more regional efforts and control costs that way. And finally, we need to have a standard rules for everyone if we're going to not do athletic fields, for example. In my town, in Wallingford, Sheehan had their fields improved and Lyman Hall didn't, so Lyman Hall had to catch up.
Thank you. Carolyn Diglio from Mark T. Sheehan High School, would you ask the next question of Mr. Falvey?
If elected, how will you make Connecticut more affordable for young people who are recent graduates of college to live and work in the state?
It goes along to everything that's been answered so far. We can make the state more affordable if we make the state less expensive. We need to have a good quality higher education so the students want to learn in Connecticut and then want to stay and earn in Connecticut. We need a partnership between industry and our education system so that we're training our students in job skills that are actually useful here in Connecticut that they'll want to stay. From an affordability point of view, if the state would stop pushing unfunded mandates on the towns wouldn't have to keep raising their property taxes to cover the bill that the state gave them. That in turn makes it more affordable to live in a community. If you want to live in the same community you grew up in, that community is getting squeezed every time the state says, you're going to do this and you're going to pay for it. Those are some of the ways that we can make the state more affordable. Our economy can grow if we give businesses a chance to grow. When our economy grows, everything becomes more affordable. I would emphasize that partnership between industries, whether it's the financial industry, the banking industry, manufacturing, hospitals, whatever the case might be, to work in tandem with our education process to make sure that we are creating well-trained people who can take well-trained, well-paying jobs and live in their communities.
Mr. Fishbein?
Carolyn, your question sets out the problem. You know, when I was your age, I wasn't thinking about government trying to make my state more affordable. I was focused on getting good grades, going to a good school, and doing well, and picking a good major. But the economy that's been created over the past 10, 15 years has added a burden to your thought process. Can I survive when I do well in school? The only way that could happen is by taxes coming down, businesses being able to grow and flourish and to create their own jobs instead of government creating jobs. The economy is healthier, and you don't have to worry about that. So generally, by concept, those are the ways that I would try and foster you succeeding in Connecticut. So thank you.
Mr. Reynolds?
Affordability, obviously, it's, you know, it involves the cost of living, but it also involves how much money, you know, you're making. So once again, getting back to what I've been saying in the campaign about partnering up, you know, advanced manufacturing, IT, biotech with colleges, creating these internships so when you get out, you have a job. Again, part of your affordability is going to be how much debt did you incur? What are you paying per month? So if we get involved, the state gets involved in making low interest loans, and then also for those students that stay in the state for a number of years, right, we can possibly reduce some of your debt. So I think that's it. Thank you.
Mr. Morgenstern, would you please ask the next question of Mr. Mace?
With a proposed shift towards mastery-based learning in Connecticut, do you plan on supporting this initiative that incites dramatic change in our schools?
I couldn't understand you. My hearing's a little bit soft. Could you say that again?
With the proposed shift towards mastery-based learning in Connecticut, do you plan on supporting this initiative that incites dramatic change in our schools?
I am unfamiliar with the mastery testing. Is that what it is?
It's a new style of teaching based on like skills and eliminating grades.
Okay. I'm unfamiliar with it, so I'm going to have to pass instead of trying to give you an answer that I know I would be sitting up here stumbling. So I'm unfamiliar with the testing and the teaching styles, so I apologize for that. I'm sorry.
Okay, Mr. Mahaley.
Anything that has to do with lack of grades, and I have to defer to Mr. Massett also. Grades, I don't think there's anything wrong with grades. For as mastering a skill, I think that's what grades are. They measure whether or not you understand something. And we shouldn't test to a test. We shouldn't teach to a test. Not really, to be honest with you, I'm not up on mastery teaching. I always graded, and that did actually a very good curve, which was very accurate. But there's too many modern ideas in education. I mean, we have people that have studied and done very well before. If Bill Gates, he didn't do mastery testing. He didn't do Common Core. So I think people like that attest to the fact that there's too much over-involvement in government, by government, either at a state level where people think they know how to make things better in that way. So I'm more of a traditionalist, and I think people have done better that way.
Thank you. Ms. Mashinsky?
I'm not familiar with that alternative method of assessment either. As long as the students are assessed in some way or other before they leave high school, that's what I'm mostly concerned with. I do not want to spend taxpayers' money remediating students who should have learned something in high school. And it really doesn't matter to me if we're using test A or test B or just mastery in the field, as long as the student can succeed in higher education at the next level.
Mr. Candelora.
Yeah, I think there's two purposes for the different type of teaching. The standardized testing, obviously, for kids that are in high school, are used as a baseline for college and for colleges to look at in the application process. But certainly, the different teaching methods, I think, are important to be utilized. My wife and I have this conversation with our three children. They're all very different. They test very differently. And I think one of our children would do very well in that type of a setting, in a mastery-based setting. So I don't think there's anything wrong with it, but I think we need to be sure that we are able to assess them and also make sure that it's keeping in line with tracking for future education, whether it be technical schools or colleges, so that when they are applying to the next level, they're not put at a disadvantage, that those institutions understand it as well.
Mr. Zabarick, would you ask the next question of Mr. Fishbein?
Connecticut ranked among the highest states in unemployment last month, and the state's Labor Department is reporting that Connecticut saw job losses last month for the third month in a row. What can the legislature do to bring jobs back to Connecticut?
Well, it's not the business of government to create jobs, but one of the ways that the legislature perhaps could foster jobs coming into Connecticut is creating a culture that makes Connecticut desirable. Currently, that culture isn't there. You know, we've heard about the bonds and, you know, negative bonding. Do you want to move your business to a state that is in that situation? Do you want to move your business to a state that you don't know what's happening next? One of the biggest hampering to business in our state is uncertainty. You know, our governor, when he ran 2 years ago, said there weren't going to be any more tax increases, and that didn't last very long. Those kinds of things, I mean, would you move your business to Connecticut with that kind of leadership at the top? Probably not. And that's unfortunate. So it's stability, it's creating a strong, business-friendly economic atmosphere. Those are the two most important things. And you know, if we you know, bribing businesses to stay is not necessarily, and I'm not talking about Sikorsky because I don't know enough about that whole situation. But, you know, during this administration, we've seen a lot of that kinds of things. And it just doesn't pan out in my experience. So those kinds of things, I think, would help the state. So thank you.
Mr. Reynolds.
First thing we need to do, we have to stabilize, you know, the state economy. And I agree. A company's going to think twice before coming to Connecticut if they don't know what the future cost is going to be. Once again, I had mentioned call for all. Have a direct line for companies that want to come to the state where they can call up and get the basic information. Again, it could be energy costs, things like that. Speaking of energy, again, create energy co-ops. I would also look into giving companies incentives for hiring people also, you know, tax breaks. The more jobs they create, the less tax burden they're going to pay. Thanks.
Mr. Falvey.
Government doesn't create jobs. Businesses create jobs. Government creates a business positive environment so the businesses can then create those jobs. 6 years ago in the Senate race, the question was asked, how do you create a job? The government employee had no idea. The business owner snapped it off in a few seconds. We need businesses to have a comfort zone to know that they will be able to create jobs and they won't be constantly changing their processes and their planning because every 2 years, new rules, new regulations, and taxes change, and they have no idea how to plan forward. If they have to put money into taxes, they cannot put money into salary. We need a business-positive environment, and that's what the government's supposed to do.
Thank you. Mrs. Shavey, would you ask the next question of Mr. Mahaley?
With the loss of jobs due to the Great Recession, many older working people have been displaced and lack the skills to get hired in newer areas of work that demand different job skills. What would you propose to help older people find new jobs?
Well, I think older people have a lot of skills that younger people don't have, and I don't think people have really raised that question. I think government should be a conduit, and I don't think government knows, again, how to create a job, but I think government should work with the private sector. Private sector knows what they're going to need, what they want. If we had, I don't like to expand government, but what I would do is I would give tax breaks, and we have to work to encourage an environment like Mr. Falvey said. I totally agree. In fact, Mr. Falvey, I think I'm going to vote for you if I have a chance. I agree with so much of what you said here. I'm going to move, I think, after the election into your district. But again, the private sector has to become more involved, and government has to allow them to do that. And as far as older workers, I think Connecticut is one of the worst places to retire in. I think government should stop taxing IRAs, and we need to be more friendly to people who are working here, because there's a tremendous economic burden that we put on our elderly, and they can't pay bills if they have to get their 401ks or IRAs taxed. So again, I would focus more on the private sector and ask them where they would actually and can use the skills of the elderly. And it could be somebody of my age. I hate to consider myself elderly, but I get a cup of coffee at McDonald's, and the guy says, okay, you're a senior cup of coffee. So it saves me money. But I'm going to end early. That's pretty much what my answer is.
Okay. Ms. Mashinsky?
I work specifically on this problem. My committee did an older worker report, and we looked at the difficulty of people over 50 years old in getting a new job when technical change in particular cost them their job. These are hardworking people. They show up on time. They're very reliable, but their skills are no longer wanted. We set up the Platform to Employment program. It was originally a pilot in one town, made it statewide. It has retrained more than 1,000 people for new careers. They have a 93% placement rate. Virtually everyone they retrain gets a new job. And we also have an apprenticeship program called Step Up that subsidizes the wage for a period of time so the employer will take a chance on these older workers.
Mr. Candelora.
And I think to piggyback off of what Representative Mashinsky said as well, you know, our manufacturers are starting to go into the colleges. I just served on a panel at Southern Connecticut State University where we had manufacturers and teachers come in and are just educating them on what jobs are out there and making sure that curriculums are being put in place for training for the positions that are actually out there and are needed. My wife just is re-entering the workforce after 16 years and reached out to the community college system, which I think also does a great job, not just educating, but the first step was making that phone call to the system to talk about what she wants to do and how to get there. She was a certified teacher that wants to change her career into early education, and they helped create that pathway for her. So I think that we've done a lot over the last couple of years, and I think what we need to do is get that message out to people so they know where the resources are.
Thank you. Mr. Mace?
Yeah, trying to specify what was meant by older. 40s, 50s, 60s, 70s, 80s. But I think those older who wind up losing their jobs are more not of a professional employment, because people who get laid off of professional employment, they'll try and find jobs within their profession that they're used to working. But for the ones that are just common laborers, I think that what the state could do is offer them, you know, if they want to go to community college to get an education, or if they already have an associate's degree to try and go to a four-year institution. And those who want to be more mechanical, that we have, you know, auto shops or carpentry shops, if they want to get into the construction field, we should be able to give them some kind of a low-rate tuition so that they could get into the job market for a second career. And be some kind of a professional in those natures, either in the construction industry or through education.
Thank you. Mr. Chimel, will you ask the last question of the evening of Mr. Reynolds?
Patrick, I want to circle back since you came up with the bonding is the credit card of Connecticut analogy. Can you think of a project in Wallingford that got bonding that you would have said, no, send it back.
And this came up a couple of times when I was on the Board of Ed, when we were discussing, you know, the athletic or the Lemon Hall Athletic Complex or even like artificial turf. My suggestion is, and it was that we should look at this locally. I mean, and all the board members agreed, the state is spending money they don't have. So let's present it to the voters, see what the voters say. If you want new lights in Lyman Hall Field, if you want artificial turf, if you want this, we're gonna do it locally. So that's the, you know, again, with the, I was vocal against the state grant for artificial turf. This was, I think, two terms ago. But I did want to point out, though, with bonding, not all bonding is bad, all right? But the thing is, what we need to do is to look at where that money is being spent. If we're spending it on infrastructure, in other words, something that's going to improve the economy, create jobs, then bonding is good, and especially at the low interest rates. But once again, when you're talking about individual, you know, like towns, I mean, so let's say hypothetically we got $3 million bonding to do Lyman Hall Athletic Complex. What's stopping Ansonia next year going, well, we need two? And Derby going, well, we need one. In other words, you have that past practice where you're opening up Pandora's box. And I think leaving it up to the local taxpayers, I think they're the best ones to make that decision, whether we want to borrow money for improvements.
Mr. Falvey?
We need to look at bonding in terms of need and want. If it's a project that it needs to be done, then it needs to go through. If it's a project people want to have, you have to look and say, is it such a high enough priority of a want that some other need somewhere in the state of Connecticut can't get its funding? I can't speak to any particular project in Wallingford where I would say, no, send the money back. I think the process should be, if Wallingford or Cheshire or Southington in the 103rd District wants a project or needs a project, they should come to their state legislators and say, we need bonding for this, and not for the legislature to say, hey, look what I brought home for you. There's a difference between the two. We should be bonding for the needs, and we should be looking very closely as whether we should be bonding for the wants.
Mr. Fishbein.
Thank you. So earlier tonight, Representative Mashinsky pointed out how she got $3.4 million for the phosphorus remediation. And that's something that, you know, just the need for that or the mandate for that comes from the federal government down to DEEP, who puts it on the town. And there's really no basis for the underlying need for the expenditure to begin with. So what I hear here tonight is partnership. You know, if everybody in the legislature said, we are not going to bond, that's part of being the team, it's part of getting together and solving this problem. So it's a dangerous question to answer specifically locally, but assuming that everyone across the state in the legislature agreed there would be no bonding, that is one thing that I would point out is the phosphorus situation. You do it locally. We wouldn't have to send so much money to the state to get funneled back to the towns. So that's a very important portion. Thank you.
Thank you. That concludes the question and answer portion of the program. Each candidate will now have 2 minutes to make a closing statement. Mr. Mahaley, will you please begin?
I want to say thank you for everybody and the women's community group. I have that proper in
Wallingford
Community Group. It's an excellent forum to make sure everybody gets their ideas out and questions answered. You know, I'm a pretty passionate guy. And the reason I'm passionate is because I'm sincere and I believe in certain ideas. And one of my, what I pass out, it says enough is enough, and I mean it. I'd rather go down swinging than I'd rather walk away from the issues that are going on here. I go to house, I see the elderly, young children who are being affected by people who want to just keep kicking the can down the road. Well, ladies and gentlemen, we've kicked the can down a dead-end road. We can talk about bonding and everything else. There's no more Christmas presents. If I have to say that, I'm going to say it. We have to stop promising gifts to people. And we have to end career politicians who think that's the only way to get elected. I'm going to say it again. My opponent's been in office for 36 years. And the way we make sure we get the Christmas presents again is to keep raising taxes. We have to stop raising taxes. I would stop funding bonding that's just another credit card. The more we do that, we're going to get in deeper and deeper trouble. I don't care if I get elected a second time. I'm going to promise you I will do what I think is right. And I hold the voters to say to me, Mr. Mihaly, you either did it or you didn't do it. I also hold the newspapers accountable as well. We need to make sure that you hold us responsible. That's the primary responsibility of newspapers today, and we've lost that in this country. Can you imagine all the things that could be on the front line if you talked about the $5 million that was not given to the elderly or the less wealthy towns? Thank you.
Ms. Mashinsky.
I've been working very hard in all of my terms. I am a dependable person for Wallingford. I work well with my town officials who are not the same party as I am. I work well with my fellow delegation members from that also represent Wallingford. I've been working 9 years on the legislature's Premier Efficiency Committee. Our committee is a bipartisan committee that works on making programs run better with less money. In 1 year, we put together a list of $400 million worth of savings, which we passed to the Appropriations Committee. I have delivered for the district anything that the district has asked me to do, whether it be help for Lyman Hall Athletic Fields so they could be safe, or the sewage treatment plant, or the Enterprise Zone, or the Linear Trail grants, or claiming education money back for the district. I have done all those things as the district has asked me to do. Next time, I will be working again on the Connecticut Institute for the 21st Century. They have 7 major reform recommendations. I've gotten some of them passed already, and some of them are still in play. We need long-term savings to deal with the reduced revenues. Apprenticeships I've worked on for 6 years. I'm very proud of that, and able to get a new job and a new career for a person whose job is outmoded. And people should feel free to call me if they would like to get into that program. For next term, I will be working on apprenticeships again, on the reforms of the Connecticut Institute, and on the senior center connection to the Linear Trail, for which we already have grant money. I enjoy incorporating suggestions from voters and from people I door knock. And I hope I have your support to go back for another 2 years, represent the town. Thank you.
Mr. Candelora.
Thank you. Good evening. It's been a pleasure representing the town of Wallingford within the 86th district, and I would like to continue to do so. I currently serve as the deputy leader in the House, and I've served for the past years on the Finance Revenue Bonding Committee. I think one of the things that I've done over the last 8 years is really change the dialogue in Hartford in how we look at budgeting. When I first got up there and served on that committee, we basically, the legislature never had a mechanism to know what was even in our checkbooks and to know what we were bonding. Back in 2010, I was the author of a cash flow report, which the treasurer is required to put out, which shows the level of money in our checkbook, as well as how much we are borrowing. And that sort of shined the light on the real fiscal health of the state of Connecticut. A few years later, I started proposing legislation that would deal with our unfunded liabilities, our pension plans. And the comptroller had worked with me on this issue. And we have a mechanism set up that streamlines revenue. So if the stock market has a 20%, for instance, revenue gain, the state will no longer be able to increase their budget by that amount. Rather, it takes the inflationary rate and caps the budget growth at the inflationary rate, and the rest of that money goes into our rainy day fund, so it's an automatic savings mechanism that will then go to pay for our unfunded mandates and our pension liabilities. So I've worked very hard on these budget issues. I think we are at a crossroads in the state of Connecticut. I'd like to continue to bring that expertise for the town of Wallingford and for the whole state of Connecticut to get us on the right track, because I do believe that Connecticut will see better days with the right people in office. Thank you.
Mr. Mace.
Yes, thank you. First of all, I want to thank the Wallingford Community Women's Group for hosting this here. Thank the town of Wallingford for allowing us to use this facility. The moderator, I want to say thank you as well. To the panel of questioners, thank you very much for all of the questions. And to the timekeepers, your time too. And to the students, Sam and Caroline and the other two that were here before, thank you for coming down. And Sam, I'm 66 years old and you taught me something tonight. Now I have to go home and research the question you asked me so I know what I'm talking about the next time I'm in a debate. But a lot of people don't know me. I'm new to this. So let me tell you a little bit about myself. I was one of those minimum wage earners. I was uneducated, just a high school degree, working for $1.25 an hour way back when. And it wasn't until I got married and I started raising a family that I started moving up. And I went to South Central Community College. I was a mailman for 30 years. I worked for the United States Postal Service delivering mail. Went to South Central Community College, took me 10 years to get my 2-year degree. Went to Southern Connecticut, matriculated, graduated from there in 98, applied to law school. Went to Quinnipiac Law School. My daughter and I went to law school the same time. Graduated in 2003. I retired from the Postal Service in 2005. I know what hard work is. I know what it is to be down here and then move up here to a professional. I want to be able to do that in Hartford and represent a lot of the constituents and a lot of people who need help from the low income to get up to the middle income and from the people in low middle income to move up. And the only way to do that is to balance the budget, create jobs, and try and get people back to work and jumpstart this economy. So thank you to the audience for very much for coming. I really appreciate your attendance and thank you very much.
Mr. Fishbein.
Thank you. You know, it's fitting that it's a week before Halloween and we're talking about who we're going to elect as our leaders. You know, 2 years ago, our governor wore a mask during the political season. He said that everything was fine, that we had surpluses, there weren't going to be tax increases. Shortly thereafter, he took off the mask. We learned that there were significant deficits and there was going to be tax increases, the second highest series of tax increases that this state has ever seen. This election season, we continually see Democrats that are running for Malloy. And they've learned that that's not going to win, that that path is not going to set us on a prosperous future. I don't wear a mask. You know that I have always fought for smaller government, for zero tax increases, for open and transparent government. That has been my record as a member of the town council. What I heard my opponent here tonight talk about was breaks for college loans, tax incentives for creating jobs. The question is always, well, who's going to pay for it? You know, college loans, are we going to stiff the banks? Are we going to stiff the taxpayers? Tax incentives for creating jobs, are we going to stiff the taxpayers to pay for it? It's just going to create more of a problem. That is not how you run an economy, on a wing and a prayer. I'm asking you to vote for me on November 8th in the special election as well as the regular election, 5B and 6B. Thank you, good evening, and God bless America.
Mr. Reynolds.
Yes, first I'd like to thank the Wallingford Community Women, students from our each high school, members of the press, and of course, the audience. What I'm gonna just stick to is why I'm running for office. Once again, some of you have heard this, that I was raised in a family where community was an extension of family. My father was a police officer here for decades, served the people of Wallingford. My mother and sister were involved in the community. I decided to take the education route. Taught high school for 21 years, college for 28. Then I decided to get on the Board of Ed. Now I feel ready for the for the next step up, which is state representative. One of the things I'm going to bring to Hartford is my diversity. I have had my own painting business. I've worked as a carpenter. I worked for two major corporations for 7 years. I've sat down with CFOs, CEOs, talked business. I've also negotiated contracts, both from the labor side when I was union vice president in New Britain High, and also on the management side. The thing, though, that I have seen, especially I'm a political junkie, that really upsets me, though, and this is another thing I'm going to bring to the state capitol, is the difference between constructive criticism and destructive. Time and time again, I hear, well, you did this last year, or 5 years ago, or this administration, and this and that. All right, it was wrong. So what are you going to replace it with? You're going to lower taxes. How are you going to lower taxes? Your taxes are too high. You're going to create jobs. How are you going to do that? I mean, as long as I've been an educator, I've told my students there's destructive criticism and there's constructive. And I just want to assure everybody that when I go up to Hartford, I didn't allow destructive criticism in my classroom, and I will not tolerate destructive criticism at the state capitol. You see something's wrong, give me a solution. And one last thing, my philosophy up there is we debate, we negotiate, and then we legislate.
Thank you. Mr. Falvey.
Thank you to the Wallingford Community Women for hosting this and for the wide range of thought-provoking questions, especially from the students. You should be commended. We've heard about all the problems that Hartford has gotten itself into. For 6 years, there's been one-party rule up there. For nearly 40 years, the Democrats have controlled the House of Representatives. Look where it's gotten us. We need some change. We have seen, over the past just couple of years, $2 billion in tax increases, $2 billion in deficits, a $4 billion swing in just a couple of years. Senator Everett Dirksen once said, a billion here and a billion there, and pretty soon you're talking real money. Well, that's real money, that's your money, and if we continue with one-party rule, it's not going to change. The 103rd District comprises a portion of Wallingford, a portion of Cheshire, and a portion of Southington. We'll be sending a new legislator to Hartford. Our current legislator is retiring. I may be a freshman legislator when I get up there, but that doesn't mean I don't already have experience. I have served on the Youth Services Committee and the Town Employee Retirement Board. I served 2 terms, 8 years on the Cheshire Board of Education, where I was vice chairman for 4 years. I served 2 terms, 4 years on the Town Council. I have 12 budget cycles under my belt. I was on the negotiating team dealing with the largest union in town. I have the experience to do these things. I'm looking to go to Hartford, as I've been saying all along, to change the way the state government runs. Look at all the agencies, all the departments, and settle on core services that the state government should be doing and getting out of the way of everything else. I'm Andy Falvey. I'm the Republican candidate for the 103rd District, and I'm asking you please for your vote on November 8th.
Thank you. Kathy, would you please read the message from Ms. Linehan?
This is a prepared statement. My name is Liz Linehan, and I'm your Democratic candidate for state representative in the 103rd District. I apologize for not being able to attend this forum last minute. My family and I were exposed to rabies this afternoon, and we are currently at Yale receiving appropriate treatment. Please know I would be here if I could. I should also take this opportunity to remind you all to vaccinate your pets as we did to make a situation like this easier to handle. I would like to take this opportunity to let Wallingford residents know that I intend to be an open, caring public servant, as I have been in my 2 terms on the Cheshire Town Council. I will bring with me a unique multi-generational perspective, as I have 3 young children in the school system, and I also care for my aging father with the onset of dementia. My background in public service, paired with my experiences as a young family and tackling issues related to seniors, allows me firsthand knowledge and intimate experience to better serve a greater swath of the population I seek to represent. In my first week in office, I will propose that your Social Security income be exempt from the state income tax, and that Connecticut incentivizes young professionals to come to our fine state and add to the tax base.
I will fight to implement a results-based accounting system so that we know which state programs aren't working and we can cut them from the budget instead of taking taking from our much-needed services like education and the Department of Social Services. I also have experience bringing much-needed services to the community without any cost to the taxpayer, such as Logan's project, a unique police training program which seeks to better the communication between our first responders and young adults and adults with autism. I also created a women's self-defense course free for residents after some groping incidences in Cheshire. This program runs twice monthly through the end of the year. These and other programs I have created represent my commitment to community and my ability to do so in a fiscally responsible manner. I look forward to implementing my proactive and community-centered approach as your state representative in the 103rd District. Thank you.
Thank you. This concludes the 2016 Candidates Forum. On behalf of the Wallingford Community Women, I thank you for watching and remind you to please vote on November 8th.